So, my name is Lukas. I remain in the security part of Nextcloud, and I will talk a little bit today about what security is for us. Like, what are the processes, what do we do, and what technical level can we implement to make the product secure. So, first of all, it's a little bit naive, but I always say security bugs are expensive. So, security bugs are expensive runs for us, because if it is a logical issue with an API, it's very, very hard to fix. You have to fix it in a backwards compatible way, you have to touch all the versions which are very, very old. This is an intense investment. And for you, obviously, data breaches are a major concern, or compliance reasons, you have to update in a certain time frame after the release. And so, our general idea is to prevent and mitigate security issues before they already exist. So, invest money before something happens, because in the end, that will be cheap. So, I'm a fan of the Microsoft Security Development Lifecycle. It's basically different steps that show what you do at which point in development, and I'll show a little bit what we do in which step. Right? So, first of all, before you develop something, you need some kind of training for developers, right? For this, we have, for example, documentation. It's not to see, but this is basically the developer manual, and you see several security guidelines, and we explain in there what is this kind of security bug, how can you avoid it, and like practical examples so that the developer can understand what our issues are all about. And we do internal and public security training. So one example will be tomorrow open. No, Sunday evening I will have secure the Nextcloud application talk, and we'll go together with the developers for the Nextcloud application and look at how to make it more secure. This will be quite cool, and if you want to attend, you're welcome. Okay. And if we fix an issue, actually we ask developers to fix it themselves. So if somebody has had a security bug, it's like, hey, can you please fix it instead of somebody else? Because then you actually learn what you have done wrong, and you can. You probably don't make the same mistake again the next time. So that's something nice. Not everybody likes it, but it's nice. So, and obviously, before you develop a feature, you first think a little bit about what are the security and privacy requirements, and what are they impact. And we actually have a small threat model which defines what is the specific category of user allowed to do. So, for example, what may an administrator do and what may a general user do? And this is documented, and this is something that we can cooperate with customers. So, if a customer has a specific security requirement that comes to us, and you can look into it, and you can, in implementation steps, work towards it for future releases. So, always ask them if you have any questions regarding that. So after you have developed something, you actually need to check, or while you are developing it, you need to check if it is really secure. What we do there is we do permanent static and dynamic security scans. There are these fancy expensive tools that you can use. One of these is RIP, the other one is that should be priority. Right? What it actually does is you throw your source code in there, it looks at the paths, like this is how the user where the user inputs data. This is how the code ends, and these are functions where potential user input in their disables. Like if you have a function that allows you to execute the shell comments, and if it somehow user input runs, and then you, this program will point out, are you really sure this data is escaped, or are you really sure you want to do this? And you also do some kind of dynamic testing, so it's not all automatic, possible. Automated static scans are nice, but they don't solve anything. It's basically a very dumb insurance. So if an automated scanner finds something, you can be sure there will be some other things in the code which are way bigger mistakes. And we have strict mandatory code review process. So before something can enter a product, it needs to be reviewed by at least two people. So in the end, at least three people have looked at it, yourself, somebody else, and again somebody else. And this actually works this way. So you open a book request, then you describe, hey, this is the reason I do this change. And probably mention more people, like, for example, if it is something about sharing, you mention Björn and ask Björn to take a look at it. Björn then basically has to review the change, so somebody else, and they say, hey, this looks good to me, my work, let's merge it. And only then, the two people have put this, you can merge it. There's actually a technical enforcement on this, so you can press the merge button before some other people have said yes. So it's not possible to merge something on your own in a malicious way unless you are letting this way of project. And also with in every language you have some kind of unsafe functions. Unsafe functions is something which in most cases you don't really need. So there are functions, if you ever use them, you're probably doing something wrong. And if user input lands in them, you probably end up with a remote code execution or something like that. And we actually have a static scanner tool within ML repository which checks as well on the forbidden functions. So functions like unserialize are forbidden, and if you use them, this scanner will actually point it out that you are using unsafe, please don't do it. Obviously this is not perfect, but it's just a lot of insurance. Because if you really want to do something evil, you can still write the unserialize in some other way that is dynamically evaluated. But this will be spotted in the normal programming process. And something automized is secure defaults. So when we develop something, we think about how can we implement it in a way that's secured by default. So even if the developer has no idea what they're doing, like you are having some aids in front of people type of thing, it should still be reasonable secure. So the worst case that should happen is something breaks, but nothing should totally make a big security problem. One example here that's a nice one is actually the controllers we use. So this is the function that shows the login formula, so the login page. What you basically see here in front of the function definition, you have so-called annotations. So you have this add sign, and behind this add you basically write, hey, this is a public page. If you don't write this page will only be accessible by administrators. So you can explicitly say this function is available to the public or for login users or for whatever category you want to mention, alright? What we also do is we enforce cross-site request forgery checks. So cross-site request forgery is basically a type of security vulnerability where you are logged in on a website and you are logged in using cookies, right? And these cookies are sent from every other website you open as well. So if you open, for example, my website, and on my website I have a JavaScript that sends a request to you on and to you next cloud. Then it will contain the cookies and it will be authenticated, right? What we actually have is we have a shared secret on the browser side and on the server side. And if you not explicitly opt out, this secret will be internal. If it doesn't match, it will fail hard. And also other implications we have, like for example, the session is only read-only by default, and if you want to have write with the video session, you need to actually say, I want the session. Another example is we have this awesome file system which we use. So a developer actually doesn't use directly the functions to write on the operating system, file system. It uses the abstraction layer like all the files, view, or the node API, or the public API. And in this, there are some nice things like if you change it in the folder, you should not be able to escalate out of it. So if you do a ././ and you are in this folder, you should not end up something above this folder. So the worst that can happen is that an attacker could make something like this folder, but not something else. And obviously now we are at the stage where we have looked at this most on our own, we have automatic tools to look at it, and now we need some other people to look also at it, right? So we have a successful bug bounty program with high payouts. We use the Hector 1 platform, which is used by more than 3,000 hackers out there and other projects companies are also using the platform like Yahoo, Twitter, and you name it. And what it basically is about is a platform where you can submit security bugs to a specific company and they evaluate it and you will pay if it's a valid security issue. And if it is not a valid security issue, you don't get paid. So, and we basically offer the highest rewards in the open source world. I have some details to name with that. So if you look at this, this is the maximum reward we are paying, this is $5,000. So we pay somebody else $5,000 if they find a critical security issue. If you compare with other projects like Apache, you are at, I think, $3,000 for critical security issues. And if you look at very multi-billion dollar companies like Dropbox, you only see they are not offering significantly more compared to their pocket size like that. Just probably more than us as a smaller German company. And if you look at other open source projects, you see that the rewards are usually still low. And eight people can actually look at the clones and try it. So it's not only one person. So if I get hit by a train or by a bus, people can still look at it. So if you look at the response timings, this is the response efficiency. And you see that we have an average time to first response of 5 hours. That's actually the top performance of the website. Because if you look at it, all the production programs take like 1 or 2 weeks to first respond to you, which is obviously not so awesome if you want security vulnerability, because you want quick feedback. And most of the people on there also do it not only for the pay, but also for the money. If you have to wait 2 weeks to be a tier to get any money, you probably don't report anything else to them in the future. So, next slide, come on. So if you look at the amount of work that this bug bounty program creates, you see this is the scale. We can read this above 240. This is 100 here. So you see when we have started the program, we got like 240 new calls in a day, which was a little bit annoying to try. And nowadays we are down to just 1 to 2 reports a week, which is way more manageable. But if you compare to the payoffs actually that we have here, you see we have only paid out $1,500 up to now. And those are all for China minor vulnerabilities. And most of the vulnerability reports are actually not vulnerabilities at all, but somebody who understood the software or something like that, right? So you see 90 bucks have been resolved, but again, not all of the 19 were in a product, some were in a website, some were in some misconfiguration on servers, kind of that. And we got like 400 reports in total, so that's a very high signal noise ratio. And once we have identified the vulnerability, either ourselves or somebody else, we publish CVE identifier. So CVE identifier is basically just a number which is unique to this vulnerability. And if you talk in the future about this vulnerability, you can say CVE-215-ZZ1 instead of this vulnerability we had 2 years ago, which did this and that, which is not really something easy to communicate and everyone thinks of someone else, some other vulnerability at this point. So we didn't publicly disclose the vulnerability, not directly when we released, but a little bit later or not in it. Later as well. And when we release the vulnerability advisory, it's not so good to see, we might have a nice advisory. And this advisory using basically a risk assessment, which is a number between 0 and 10. 0 is it has no security impact at all, 10 is this is very, very bad. And I always say up to 6 you can basically sleep, and when it's over 6 you better get up to fix it very soon. And that's a nice way to communicate it, but you also write sometimes below medium, high, critical, get out of the metrics now. But most of the vulnerabilities are actually very, very low vulnerabilities, right? We also have an impact description and a vulnerability description, like this this release fixes this and that vulnerability. This is what the network can do if they exploit this vulnerability. And then the usual stuff like being is like which software is affected, which versions, there's a patch implemented, like certain acknowledgement, like this person reported it, thank you very much. And when these advice always basically 14 days after the release. So what we do is we release a version, wait 14 days, and then we release this information. For customers to release this information often at the same day as it release. And if it is a more or less critical issue, we also provide them with patches in advance. So we can say that this huge issue is that it has this and that impact, we plan to make a release in 1 week, but if you want, you can already apply this patch now, and you will be protected. But that's obviously up to them, but we do provide them with the choice to apply security patches in advance and deliver. And then if you look at the statistics of vulnerability reports, this shows some nice data. So this is the fixed and stored vulnerability per year. So what you have to look at is probably the blue line, which shows the server vulnerabilities. And 2015 we were at something about 10. And you may now think, oh, 10 is a huge number of possible. But if you look at other programs like SharePoint or some other enterprise software like that, you will see 10 is actually not that huge, right? Now it gets a little bit more interesting. So this is the statistics of the reports by internal people in Google, by external people in overall. If you see, most of the vulnerabilities are actually from internally. This is since 2012. If you now look into the single years, you see in 2012 we had like lots of vulnerabilities because. So how this handle is basically we release an advice update for every vulnerability. So if you have one type of security check missing, you have this type of vulnerability like 20 times. But you only handle one time. So this is actually caused by one type of generic vulnerability which applied throughout the platform in 2012. And you see, this is 25 vulnerabilities this time, some critical ones, some medium ones, and there also were major external reports. So the orange bar you can actually see. In 2013, you can also see the orange bar that is actually going down the amount of reports. And if you look at 2014, you see it's actually gotten way harder to find vulnerability. Because the external contributions went down to a very low amount. And if you look at 2015, you see that despite having, for example, a bug bounty program, the vulnerabilities that were reported by external people were actually of very low severity. And the really critical vulnerabilities were all found by internal people. Internal here defines anything employed by Nextcloud here in the Okay. Now a little bit about some security hardenings in elements for product. I think in the last of these, I've got some time here. So, for example, CSP and the same site cookies. So, I don't know if you know something about content security policing. Content security policing basically prevents the execution of inline JavaScript. I have an example of this later. We implemented this in 2013 as a first proof of concept, it worked, right? And over time, we have always been hardened to release, like market make it even stricter. And other competitions have implemented it in 2015, despite having probably way more developers or more issues on this topic in short. Anyhow, so you see, and you mean it also, this is for example the HTML form which allows you to enter your name. So what you will see if you open this browser is an input field, then you can enter your name, and if you have entered your name, it says hello. Name, right? So, as an attacker, what you could do now is basically enter something like a script other one. So, you enter basically an HTML or JavaScript. It isn't escape, it is directly put into the output. Then, this means you would see this also error window. So, what an actually attacker would do is not show an error box to you, but make something like create a new user with this password or set your password. Or do some other messy stuff. Basically, with XSS, you can put everything that the user can do in his current session for this website. So, if the user can click the new user, you can also do their XSS. So, what you basically do to prevent most of it is sending ahead that it impacts the browser to not execute inline JavaScript. So, what we say is, if By default, everything is forbidden. You can't execute anything. But for javascript, they are allowed if they come from the same domain. So from a file from the same domain. But not if they come from the same domain in the HTML directory. And then we have the same kind of policies for all file types, like images are allowed from their own domain, but you can also embed them inline because there's no security risk on that. And this policy is way longer and short here, but we, the end point is now we only allow content from the same origin. So if you now have, for example, security vulnerability like access as in Nextcloud, what you can see is this fancy security error which says, sorry, you can't execute this in our JavaScript because it is not allowed by the policy. So if there is a XSS vulnerability, in most places there is no impact because most browsers actually support at the moment. There is one exception coming from the House of Redmond in the United States. So if you use Internet Explorer, you might want to update your Edge because then you have also this nice security hardening, but the core of the browsers is supported since the ages. Okay, what we also do is I have already talked about XSF before. So XSF is this type of vulnerability you open on a website. And the other website sends a request to your Nextcloud, and Nextcloud doesn't know if the request comes from you or from this website. It just assumes, yeah, your attention page and everything is fine. Again, what we do against this is we have a shared secret, which prevents this type of vulnerability. But what we also do is have same site cookies. Same site cookies are currently only implemented in Chrome and Opera. And Firefox has said, yeah, we are working on this, so probably in 1 or 2 years we will also have Firefox. And what actually does is, this is one cookie which authenticates you, so please ask for a text file, which has something that tells the server, yes, I'm this user. And what is there is this additional attribute where we can say, this cookie can only be sent from the same domain. So if you visit, an Eagle website and sends a request to your next cloud, what will actually happen is this cookie will not be sent by your web browser and you can actually detect, oh, this cookie has not been sent, so this request has been sent by another website. And what we do is we enforce this actually for every action controller. We enforce that this cookie has been sent, and action controller is something that changes something. So if I have a controller which changes in the setting, actually, this cookie has been sent, which is only sent from the same domain. And for every view controller, we require the next cookie, which is pretty much the same, but is sent in a few more places. So, if you open a website, you can't require this link from every time, because if you click on a link to Nextcloud, it will only send the last cookie. So that this browsing still serves, we only have to start the collection. Controllers and for all other controllers, like view controllers that show something, we require only the less secure version, which is still better than nothing, but that's how it has to be implemented, that the browsing still actually works. So, I think I have now shown lots of information to you, and now I have lots of extra questions. Yes?
How do you protect the App Store against that apps?
So, okay, good question. So, at the moment we are using the robot install right now, but for the next version we use the Nextcloud App Store. And the Nextcloud App Store has some type of security built-in that the other one isn't. So what is implemented is every app has to be signed with a certificate. And if the app isn't signed, you can't even upload it. Okay. And the certificate has to be issued by a certificate or code. A certificate to a TA that belongs to us. So if somebody wants to develop something, they just have to fill out this fancy form and we have to look at the app and see, yes, this is a legit app or this is absolutely nothing. And then we either give this certificate or not. So we have some kind of platform to deliver, right? So once they have the certificate, they can update the app and find it. And the nice thing about this is, so even if the app store is hacked and somebody else has control over all the data on the app store, this won't affect you as a user, because what an attacker can do is sign the apps. They don't have the private key. They only can serve you something, but Nextcloud will verify the signature. And if the signature doesn't match, it will say, oh, App Store has been hacked and it's installed. So this is kind of nice. Any other questions? That's it for me. Oh.